Well, hello everyone. It's a little bit late, so let's see if I'm able to wake some of the people in the audience. My name is Hugo Giralt. I'm a Spaniard. I'm an entrepreneur. I came to the United States after working for many years in the corporate world, in Coca-Cola, Telefonica, UNICEF, big, large organizations. And I had a dream, as many of you. I had a dream to come to Silicon Valley. And in order to do that jump, I came to study a master in industrial design in Art Center College of Design, which is amazing design school. It's in Pasadena, close to Los Angeles. So I went there, and something magical happened that I met my business partner, which is an Indian, that is actually three doors to the right. We have our design studio. He's working right now while I'm here with you. And we are eight people now, and we met each other. And in the first day of orientation, we didn't even start at the master. We talked to each other like, what do you want to do? Why you're here? And I was like, well, I'm here because, you know, I want to go to Silicon Valley. I'm here actually, you know, to learn about design. And I actually want to meet someone to actually, you know, create a design studio together. And he's like, I came with the same agenda. And we were like, that's amazing. So we did the thesis together. We worked for 2 years, and we created Propelland. I want this presentation to be as useful to you as possible. So what I'm going to share with you is actually how we tackle the projects. We're working, as you will see, for big brands, big companies, but at the same time with a lot of startups, as we are also a startup, right? So I want to share with you how we work. The first thing about disruptive innovation that you're reading a lot of books and everyone is talking about it is really this sweet spot between these three axes. The first one is human values. This is very, very important. All the design research and all the specifics of design thinking is really about human behavior. The second one is actually the intersection with technology. And the third one, of course, is business. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that. We help basically as a company to other companies actually to make them grow. When someone comes to a design studio, they ask really, hey, how can you help me with, you know, new products and new services that actually can make me to grow? So this is very, very important. Everyone, especially in Silicon Valley, we all think about how we can actually scale, right? So we really believe in the simplicity that actually products and services can bring actually to human experiences. This is where we're focusing our work. This is our design studio, three doors to the right. Some of you have already visited. You are more than welcome as Spaniards and part of the family. It's kind of like Camarote de los Hermanos Marx. I don't know how to but sorry for lack of translation to you. And basically, it's like this space where we have 3D printing machines, laser cutters, so all sorts of smells of plastic being burned, people with Arduino, the lights coming off because someone blew something up, and that's kind of like our day-to-day. So we work on the digital aspect, but also on the physical aspect of things, and I'm going to talk a lot about that. Our day-to-day looks really like this. Work on pain points about a user experience for any product, for any service. We do card sorting, touch points, flow, personas, scenarios. We draw a lot. User flows, co-creation sessions, ideation sessions with our clients. Actually, this is Manolo Moore from BBVA. That is one of our clients. And then we visualize all that in what we call also days in the life of. We're going to show some examples of that. So when we talk about human experiences, it's actually this intersection of the physical and the digital. As you have seen also in the presentation from Sergi, we're starting to enter into this era of the Internet of Things where everything is actually connected. Not only people to machines and machines to people, but actually machines to machines. All that is going to be require actually people like all of you to actually redesign how all those things are going to be actually talking to each other. What are actually the human experiences and the experiences for the machines that are actually going to be happening? This is a huge, huge opportunity. We work with big companies, with startups, and also with incubators. And today is our birthday. We make our first year. So we. Thank you. So we are super, super excited after 1 year of a lot of learnings. When we talk about also disruptive innovation, I wanted to put here a little bit also of history. Where is this coming from? Well, it's coming from because basically in the 80s, we lived that era where everything was made in Japan and in Taiwan. Everything was focused in cost and quality, actually management. And then something happened in the 90s when everybody started to actually focus as organizations in business efficiencies and processes. And is that internet was born. 1995, the entry barriers to actually generate services, to create services, really lowered down compared to products. And that's the curve that you see here of services that started to boom. There were more companies actually being created in the United States related to services than actually to products. Products kept going down. In the 2000s, everyone was talking about customer experience and e-business, how we can become digital, right? All the e-commerce stores, CRM platforms, loyalty programs. So something happened at the end of the 2007, iPhone and the ecosystem with the App Store. What happened there is that the entry barrier actually to create services even lower more, and everyone started to do even more services because now that you had this huge installed base actually of people with smartphones, and actually the possibilities were endless. And in the 2010s, everyone is talking about what is called transformational business innovation or disruptive innovation. We talk a lot about what has happened is that also Steve Jobs have died. Everyone has read, of course, in the organizations, especially the CEOs of the large organizations have read the biography of Steve Jobs and has asked all the direct reports in the top management, why we're not like Apple, right? Why we're not doing what they're doing? So that's a little bit what's happening. If you put this in context, which is pretty mind-blowing, in the United States, close to 80% of the economy is related to services. This does not mean, which is a very important message, that actually physical goods is less important. What you see here, the weight is just 20%. Actually, the huge opportunity, based also on what you have seen on the trends that Sergio was commenting with you, is in this intersection. That connectiveness that we're seeing with companies like Nest, Google's, Tesla's, etc., all that is coming in this intersection. So when that's happening, the most wanted profiles that you can see in Silicon Valley right now are actually the user experience designers. User experience or service designers, as they are actually calling them also now. We call them unicorns. And there's a joke in the sector a little bit right now in the industry, because you start to read like some job descriptions that are asking for, I'm looking for a user experience designer that knows the physical aspect but also the digital aspect, that has 6 to 7 years actually launching this type of products, that also knows how to code, but I also want that someone that knows about industrial design, also the physical part, but also mechanical engineering, but also. And you are like, well, I mean, if you find one of those, I want to meet that person, right? It's a little bit of the situation. So what's happening, it's the end of an era. This is the guy, by the way, that has the world record of holding with just his body the largest number of spoons. He mastered, right? He practiced this for how long? I mean, this guy, right? But it's true, it's an end of an era. It's the end of the era of specialists. And we are entering, right, into this era that before, it was about the Renaissance, right? This is Raphael in the School of Athens. Amazing paintings. You see what is the interaction of actually people, everyone from different disciplines, everybody actually sharing in Greece, right? And that's what the Renaissance was actually trying to replicate. They admired that era. Today, we can see that that's actually happening in companies like, for example, Google, right? That's a little bit, Google X, that's a little bit the cross disciplines that is happening and people doing more and more things. Before the Renaissance man, we could say that it was kind of like someone like Leonardo da Vinci. Today, Sergey Brin, for example. The similarities, okay, are there. It's kind of like happening again, no? Humanity, kinds of like we tend to repeat ourselves. So when we talk about unicorns, it's important to understand what are the characteristics of these unicorns. Might not exist today, but all of you, us, we have the opportunity to become unicorns. I would say even that we have a little bit the responsibility to become unicorns, because we have the tools. So first thing when we talk about unicorns is you have to understand human behavior. Second thing, you have to have system understanding of the problems, but also system understanding of the solutions. You have to also help others to visualize. It's very important that you are able, it might not be, you know, Leonardo da Vinci like drawing and painting, but you are able to, with, you know, just some doodles, to communicate the concepts, to communicate the ideas to other people. It's very important to visualize the ideas, to share them so everyone can actually be aligned to the same goal. The physical and the digital prototyping, this is going to become second nature of the new generations. People soon are not going to be playing with Lego, are going to be playing with the parts that they have actually, you know, printed at home with the 3D printing machines. We are also talking about artistic eye and hand. I think it's something that is super important that you keep nurturing through your entire life. And of course, the most important thing, curiosity about everything. When we are hiring people right now, that we're looking, of course, for potential unicorns, we see people that, you know, are, for example, Victoria, that we have hired, comes from landscape architecture, but also has the layer of digital services. But she has a lot of curiosity, actually, to learn about many, many other different fields. That's very important. Curiosity is crucial to become a unicorn. Millennials, which I'm not a millennial, but a lot of you guys in the audience are millennials, you are actually the ones that are going to be changing everything. So please become unicorns, like Renaissance men, to keep pushing, right? We believe at Propelland that there exists this hybrid model, where actually this ecosystem where established brands, established companies, are actually on the physical and also on the digital. Physical, like for example, Coca-Cola, BBVA, these type of companies are trying to evolve into the intersection with the digital. But then we see other people, like for example, Google, with Google Glass and with all these different initiatives that they're doing, for example, with Google X, like the autonomous car, the connected car, they're evolving actually in intersection with the physical. What we are also seeing is that the startups are trying to get more and more into the partnership actually with incubators and accelerators of these companies. That's the ecosystem that is starting to happen. But also, they are trying to launch their own projects directly through other channels, like for example, Kickstarter, Indiegogo, etc., as also Sergi pointed out. So we believe in that hybrid model that actually you can be, as a company, any of you that you launch products and services, you are actually in the middle. You're not in one side, maybe you're on the other one. You are actually trying to be in the middle. What does that mean? We do three things, and always three things, for example, in our projects. And this is the type of methodology that I want to share with you, because it might be helpful. The first thing that we do is what we call identify. Identify for us is what we call a strategic future foresight. What the heck does it mean? It means that phase of design discovery where you are actually trying to connect to the human behavior and actually the contradictions, where people say that they do something, but then when you actually observe them, when you actually interview them, you see that they actually do something that is opposite of what they're saying that they do, right? It might be like about energy and how they, for example, use energy at home. They might say that they do certain things, but then when you observe them, they have all these different habits that they are not even, for example, you know, aware of. Those are the main contradictions where you can actually focus the design. That's the primary research, where you are tackling directly the human behavior of final users and experts. Then the secondary research that we normally conduct is actually more about analysis of positioning, where you are and where all the different competitors that you have are, and where they're going to be actually moving forward. The strategic future foresight is actually very important that you do it for more than 2-3 years, for example. There are a lot of companies that, for example, are doing like, in the 2020, what is going to be happening? Those type of exercises is the strategic vision of what you want to accomplish. Very, very important to identify which areas of opportunity require the least investment to have the largest impact. That's where all the organizations actually want, okay? All of us for our products and services, right? Then the second thing that we do is, okay, if you are here today, and this is what you want to accomplish, you have two ways of doing it. Normal process in large organizations is the business plan process, right? You're doing business plan, trying to go 2-3 years ahead. That's what I used to do in Coca-Cola or in Telefonica, right? So you are trying to build innovation with the inertia that you're bringing from the past towards the future. That's incremental innovation, but it's not disruptive. If you want to actually do disruptive innovation, you have to do it actually from the future towards the present. You have to do the back engineering. So what are the steps that I actually need to do from that strategic future foresight to the present? The third thing that we do is actually prototyping. We try to prototype as soon as possible, low fidelity prototype, in some cases more on the physical aspect, in some cases more on the digital, in some cases in the intersection of both, and we put that in the hands of the consumers on the experts and get as soon as possible actually the feedback on all that, right? The design thinking methodology at the end are these four phases. The first one is discovery, second one is design, delivery, and then learning. When we're talking about discovery, it's that understanding that we talk about primary and secondary research. This is like the phase of actually like very, very divergent. You're trying to hold here, which is very, very important. As humans, we tend to put our hat as Mr. Fix-It, right? We want to fix everything. Oh, I have these ideas. I call it the napkin theory. No, everybody takes a napkin and tells you, this is what we need to do. This is going to change everything, right? That's our normal tendency. As designers, it's very important that you actually hold your horses with ideas of how to resolve the problem in these phases, because otherwise you're not going to open your eyes and open your ears of what actually the consumers are telling you that the opportunity actually is. So don't build one yet, right? So that's this phase. Primary and secondary research. Then the convergence is actually taking all these observations that you have actually done and try to depict what are the largest opportunities that are going to have actually the largest impact. With that, you get here and you start to release all the horses. That's the moment where you actually go crazy and you go again in a divergence sessions with ideation sessions with all your team. And you start to actually prototype that as soon as possible. And then you start to validate with the final users and with the experts. And then you iterate as many times as possible you can. We, for example, just as something that I want to share also with you if it's useful, we don't do projects that are less than 5 weeks, for example, because we have learned that if you do projects less than 5 weeks, this, you don't have enough time to actually get the insights that are going to actually bring nice products, nice solutions, actually solutions that are going to have an impact on the human experience. And then, of course, you get into the focus on the implementation, and then very important, the measurement part. There's a huge, huge area of improvement right now that is growing in the market that is actually the measurement of innovation. I can do 10 things in an organization. Which of those 10 things actually have been more innovative? How I can measure what are the key success factors actually of those innovations, and what is actually the impact that is having to make decisions? Which decisions? The decisions actually to decide if you want to evolve that product or that service, or if you want to reinvent it completely. When we talk about end-to-end user experience, and this is interesting. I was, for example, with Sergi in GigaOM, where Jack Dorsey, a part of Twitter and Square, of course, he has like this mindset about understanding actually the end-to-end user experience. This, what it means is very important. A lot of the startups, we have a tendency to actually focusing on what's happening when someone is using our product or our service, right? But the key question is actually what's happening also before they use it. Why are they going to start to use it? How they learn about our product or our services, right? How our product and service actually interact with the rest of the ecosystem in the day-to-day. And the same thing after they have closed, for example, that app, if it's an app, for example, or they are not using that physical product and the service. What happens after? What is crucial also is to understand the ecosystem of what's physical and what's digital in the before, in the during, and in the after. That's actually understanding the end-to-end user experience. I want to share with you three examples. I could be here sharing many, many more. If you have more questions about it, I'm glad to talk. Or you know, if you want to visit our design studio anytime, we can share more examples with you. There are three that are interesting. The first one is from a large organization like Coca-Cola, and the other two are small startups. I think are going to be more useful for you guys. About Coca-Cola, they came with this opportunity that they were telling us, like, you know, we are very strong in music, we are very strong in sports, but we are nobody yet in gaming. There's a huge opportunity in gaming. Gaming right now if you add music and movies industry, it's actually bigger. And it's still in its infancy. So Coca-Cola want to play a role there. The opportunity that we depicted is that indie game developers, independent game developers, have actually right now a big challenge. And is that right now, App Store, for example, of Apple, it's concentrating that just 20 companies are right now controlling more than 70% of the total sales. So it's very hard if you are an independent game developer to actually create an app, create a game, and actually there's going to be people are going to be seeing it. It's a huge, huge, huge challenge. So Coca-Cola wants to become a facilitator for those independent game developers. That's the positioning. So our games that, with the potential that Coca-Cola has, for example, with the Coca-Cola sponsors, for example, the World Cup in Brazil, is going to be a sponsor also the Olympic Games, is going to be sponsoring, of course, the NFL, Formula One, NASCAR, NBA, like all these different sports. The first thing that you have to ask yourself is, what are the different stakeholders of this system? And this is something that in the methodology we always ask ourselves, okay, what are the different ingredients in this system? This is the part of the systematic understanding and systematic understanding of not only of the problem, but also of the solution that we were commenting before. And then what will be the end-to-end user experience? How each of those stakeholders in that end-to-end, in the before, during, and after that we were commenting, each of those stakeholders are actually going to be part of. This is a crowdsourced innovation platform that you know, you submit your ideas, you're going to be voting them, validating them, you're going to have the backing of projects, not just like Kickstarter, which is will be just the gamers, but actually venture capital firms, business angels, game studios, and of course Coca-Cola. You get the projects backed up, then you're going to be able to develop them, validate them, and then you're going to be able to scale them, get the distribution and the visibility through Coca-Cola, and the gamers are actually going to be able to have more games that actually right now from independent game developers. Another example of how to visualize what end-to-end user experience is for Instant Cup. So he was sharing with you, for example, Uber. Instant Cup is a competitor of Uber. It's the good thing that it has all these companies is that it's cashless, it's completely cashless. You give once your credit card information and from there you're able to take the taxi anytime and get out of the taxi and you have paid and you don't have any cash with you, right? So the question that they came to us is like, what can we become in the future? So we did an experience study, which is very funny because you have the role of the driver and then you have the role of the rider. So for 2 weeks, we had a taxi and we were around San Francisco driving the taxi, getting really the sense of what is actually the pain points that actually the drivers are getting and how we can actually improve the user experience. But also, we were also riders, not only with Instant Cab, with also with Uber, with Lyft, with all the different sidecar, with the different competitors. Then we visualized that what a day in the life of a driver and why a day in the life of a rider actually looks like and what are those touch points that we see in the service, and then what are the brand perceptions? Because we wanted actually to propose to Instant Cup, what if you do not transport only people? What if you actually become a company that is much broader than that? Cannot share too much about that. But how that actually, those touch points you can actually visualize is very, very important for the teams, actually to everyone have that capacity to be in the same page. This is the part of visualization that we were commenting. So examples. Okay, so we are analyzing the rider. What are you doing? What do you want to do? What is the best transportation solution? How to improve the experience? What are those different ideas? From that, we do also a lot of co-creation workshops. We really believe that innovation, disruptive innovation, is really a group sport. It's not something that you can only do alone, right? So this is a co-creation session with our client. That is Arjav from Instant Cup, the CEO and founder. They are participated by Y Combinator. Really, really interesting company. BMW is investing in them with electrical cars. So it's a lot of hype right now to become like autonomous cars taxi companies. That's why Uber and Google are exchanging so much investments. And then we see here the pain points that we identify, the new service ideas. So how can we get those pain points and turn them into areas of opportunity? How we can get those areas of opportunity into a prioritization? They are not in the same level. How we can actually put them in a priority? And then how that priority can turn into a roadmap? So it can actually become part of the business plan for a company or for a startup. That becomes what we call the service touch points map. We always give this in all the projects to our clients so they can put it on the wall and they can use it as a compass. So when you're having the meetings with your teams, et cetera, and someone comes up with an idea and you want to actually change your roadmap and what you're going to be implementing and the new update, for example, that you want to put in your app, use this as a compass. Use it and say, okay, hold on. That's great, that's an amazing idea. It's going to require certain time, certain resources, but let's cross it with the touch points and how actually it's going to benefit the user, in which way. And then we can decide. If it does, let's put it and prioritize it. If it doesn't, let's put it in another thing. This is very, very important to maintain that direction. Again, the user experience. This is the evolution that you see on our initial wireframes. You don't need to be Leonardo da Vinci, okay? Super, super low quality. But how the low quality starts to get into medium and in the final, actually, user interface. This is the final app with some of the pain points, like for example, you were not able to see the face, actually the photo of the driver, so it builds this closeness. You are able to just with one click, for example, to be able to call him, and you get actually tips from the driver, for example, while you are waiting in those minutes that Sergio was commenting before, for example, in the case also of Uber, we found this pain point that is, well, you're there bored, and then you start to use like other apps, etc. What if? Actually, the driver is sharing with you, you know, there's a sushi place actually in the city that is awesome, you know, and it starts to engage you sharing tips because we all know that taxi drivers actually know a lot about the city, right? Third example that I want to share with you that I think is a beautiful example. This is a small, a guy that finished the MBA in University of Southern California, USC. Ended up being number one. He's from Spain. His name is Mikel. Super talented guy. And a very typical story of startups that happens sometimes, right? Very technological driven. Software engineers, they create this amazing thing, this amazing technology that actually is able to tag 3D objects to people and to places. So let me explain this because it's pretty cool. You are able with a Google Glass or with an iPhone app to discover a layer that is digital over people. So I'm able, for example, with my iPhone or with my Google Glass to see, for example, what is your name?
Ruben.
Ruben has, for example, a 3D flying chihuahua around his head. And I'm discovering that and I'm like, wow, that's super cool. And I can remix content over that. So I can put a second dog that is this huge doggo that is trying to eat the chihuahua around, right? So another people can actually discover that and can make a comment and actually remix. But I can also be walking on the street and I get a notification and then I go with my Google Glass, for example, like this or with my iPhone and I'm able to discover here an amazing 3D graffiti that is animated and I'm actually seeing here in the wall and I can make a comment and it's one of the artists that actually I'm very interested so I start to follow him. So that's the technology that these guys had. But when we engage with them, we ask them like why people are going to be using this in their day-to-day. It was not so obvious. Who is your core user? How actually are you going to integrate with the other social networks? How are you going to actually engage into the critical mass of users that you actually need? They didn't know. Very technical oriented, but not so much on the user experience at all, right? So what we did for them is we talked with a lot of people, a lot of consumers, a lot of technical experts, and then what we did is what we call a narrative of what are all the excuses of communication that a tool like that will be able to provide to people. In the day-to-day of one person that is a Friday since she wakes up until she goes into the bed. We go there into the next level, which is we create an icon to communicate what is the functionality that it would require to make those excuses of communication happen. Why is this so crucial? Because if you are able to do this, you are able to start to see patterns. And those patterns give you exactly what is the architecture for the app. What is the first level, the second level, and the third level of navigation. We all believe in design that there are three reads. The first read, the second read, and the third read. Right? The first read is, if I get my iPhone and I show it to you just 1 second, and then I put it in my pocket, I ask you what it is, you will probably say it's a black thing, probably some people will say, and it looks like has something that is glass and probably some mobile phone. That's it, right? But if I show it to you, maybe you know like 3 seconds, and then I ask you what it is, then you're probably going to say it's probably an iPhone 5. It has this button here, et cetera, et cetera. And if I give it to you and you are able to look at it like for 1 minute, you're going to actually say that it has 2 screws in the bottom, it has a number of holes, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So those are the 3 reads. Our brain works in that level, from the broad into the detail. So that's very important to also understand how from the user experience in the day in the life of you are able actually to build that hierarchy, for example, for your apps, for your services. This is just an example of the type of flows of how to visualize something that you do in my brand app, how actually it relates into the rest of the existing social networks. Basically to see how you actually generate new user acquisition, but also to visualize with the team how you can actually generate incremental sales. So this type of flows, super useful actually to visualize. Example of wireframes and the final thing. So one last tip, because I have Jose telling me that it's about time. So one last tip, done is better than perfect, super important, okay? Don't search for the perfection, because it's about actually putting out there in the market as soon as possible so you can get as much feedback as possible to refine it. That's something that is super, super important. There's never a point where you feel that actually the app is totally perfect. Any of the apps that you have seen have had many, many, many different updates. So try to put it as soon as possible into the market. And remember that we all need unicorns. So hopefully this have inspired some of you to become maybe a unicorn. Some of you probably, you know, you feel that you're already there on the track. We all need you. And if you have any questions, I would love to actually answer them. So thank you so much.